Well, good morning. Last week, we began a new series here at Southside Bible Church. We're giving our time and our attention to the 23rd Psalm. Oh, how I love the 23rd Psalm. It's just six verses of pure delight. How many have been comforted and encouraged in this psalm over the centuries is numerous. It's easily the best known and probably the most loved of the psalms, and it has a very special place in my own heart, because of the beautiful picture and reality of what God is to his people. So I think it's one of my favorite metaphors, and it's just pure gold. I'm praying and asking God to make it green grass and still waters to us, to bear really the fruit of contentedness and the loving care of the good shepherd. That sweet spot when we know and understand the reality of this psalm, the place that God wants us to dwell as his people. He doesn't want us to be skittish, afraid, wanting, sick, malnourished, or troubled. The good shepherd said, "My peace I give you, my peace I leave to you." In fact, last week we saw the purest fulfillment of this psalm has come in Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ said, "I am the good shepherd." Just a shepherd doesn't do anything. We've seen hirelings in John 10 with bad character. We need Yahweh as the shepherd to get us to the place of absolute contentment and absolute trust. When Jesus was born, he was the fulfillment of the promised king. He was from the seed of David and he was from heaven. He came and he was the good shepherd and he laid down his life for the sheep. And he is a good shepherd. He is the good shepherd and he is my shepherd. Let's open up this morning. Just keep your hand in Psalm 23 and flip over to John 10. And we'll read that, and then we'll open in prayer and look at this passage that's before us. John 10. Jesus stands up that day in front of the multitude and began to preach. "Truly, truly, I say to you, he who does not enter by the door into the fold of the sheep, but climbs up some other way is a thief and a robber. But he who enters by the door is a shepherd of the sheep. To him the doorkeeper opens, and the sheep hear his voice, and he calls his own sheep by name, and he leads them out. When he puts forth all his own, he goes before them, and the sheep follow him because they know his voice. And a stranger they simply will not follow, but will flee from him because they do not know the voice of strangers." This figure of speech Jesus spoke to them, but they did not understand what those things were which he had been saying to them. Jesus therefore said to them again, "Truly, truly, I say to you, I am the door of the sheep. I am the way into the presence of God. I'm the door. And all who came before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not hear them. I am the door. If anyone enters through me, he shall be saved and shall go in and out and find pasture," like we're learning in Psalm 23. "The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they might have life and might have it abundantly. I am, ego a me, I am the good shepherd. And the good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. He who is a hireling and not a shepherd, who is not the owner of the sheep, beholds the wolf coming, and he leaves the sheep and he flees, and the wolf snatches them and scatters them. He flees because he's a hireling and he's not concerned about the sheep. But I am the good shepherd, and I know my own, and my own know me. Even as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. And I have other sheep which are not of this fold, and I must bring them also, and they shall hear my voice, and they shall become one flock with one shepherd." Let's go before God and we'll pray this morning. Father God, we come before you, and I thank you for Psalm 23, for I see the glories and the beauties of what happens when Yahweh is our shepherd. And Lord, I thank you for this day in history that we just read when Jesus Christ stood up and declared that he is Yahweh and that he is the good shepherd. And he's not a hireling. He is the one, we hear his voice, and he leads us out of this world and the bondage to the devil and our flesh and sin and the law. God, we thank you for the good shepherd who came and laid down his life for his sheep. God, we now can find pasture with the Lord of Lords and the King of Kings. We are now the sheep of his hand. We are cared for and we are protected. And so, Lord, I pray this morning that this reality would fall on every believing heart. Lord, every heart that is troubled, let not your heart be troubled. Believe in God and believe also in me, declared Christ. I pray that the hearts would be settled because we dwell under the Good Shepherd. We are cared for. We are protected. We have all provision. We thank you for your sovereign hand that declares no one can snatch us out of it. God, I thank you. I thank you for this beautiful salvation that we have. By your Spirit, let every heart now make the application of this reality. God, for we need your Spirit to guide us through your word here this morning. So God, we look to you alone and we praise you for the Lord Jesus Christ. And it's in that precious name that we do pray. Amen. Psalm 23, turn back. This is a psalm of David. He was a shepherd and he learned some deep things from contemplating his occupation and his God. Scripture has presented God to be a shepherd of his people that we looked at last week, beginning as early as Genesis and throughout the Bible. David now has pondered this and he wrote this song of praise for us. This is really a well cared for sheep's view of the shepherd. David so understands this connection, it's given his life to it, to the care of sheep, and he's understanding something of the Father and the way he cares for us. And so last week we began considering this psalm, and we looked at the first phrase was all. And it was just so pregnant with meaning that I wish all of us could spend a summer maybe caring for sheep, right? Wouldn't that be beautiful? Just get away and go learn these lessons that Psalm 23, verse 1, the Lord is my shepherd. And we saw the key to the whole thing. That word for Lord, that is Yahweh, the four unspeakable letters, the word for God. And that gives life to this psalm and to our lives. It doesn't matter if anyone else was my shepherd, I can't find peace. But because this is who my shepherd is, Yahweh God is my shepherd. And a shepherd is the beauty of how he would care for his sheep. And this psalm will flesh out really the holistic care that a shepherd would give to his sheep. So each week we will just keep learning of the beauty and the holistic way that a shepherd cared and genuinely gave himself for these sheep. And so the Lord, Yahweh, is a shepherd of our souls. We are his sheep and he is protecting and caring and giving us all that we need. And so this presupposes something as well this morning is that it says that we're sheep. It's a great analogy. It's used often in Scripture. Sheep were the most spooked creature alive. If any of you have ever been a shepherd, you would just smile at that. We're just easily spooked and scared and run. It's just a great analogy. They were a very stubborn animal, very needy, a needy animal. They absolutely cannot care for themselves. They can't run wild and survive. They have no ability to survive on their own. They must be cared for by a shepherd. They have no defense system. In fact, if they are attacked by a predator, they flock together to make it easier for the wolf to get them. They have nothing to protect themselves, and they're not smart, and they just flee together. They have no sense of direction. They can be lost from home just 100 yards away. They cannot find their way. That's my life story. I make one wrong turn and I don't know where I'm at. A sheep, we have no sense of direction how to find home. They just flat out are the most dependent animal upon another to care for them. Their very nature and existence and makeup then demand that they must have a shepherd. But with a good shepherd, they become one of the most contented animals known to man. The beautiful picture we all know of deep green grass, I think you've probably seen them with the fat, contented sheep laying there so peacefully, and you just kind of look at it and go, ah, that would be nice. I like that picture. That is what we're shooting for in Psalm 23. That is what the good shepherd does for sheep. And so one of the first steps is acknowledging then that we're sheep and that we are in need. We have no self-sufficiency in ourselves. The gospel really begins with a poverty of spirit that I don't have resources to fix myself and to get right with God and to stay right with God. So I acknowledge right out of the gate, I'm a sheep. I am in need. I have no self-sufficiency in myself, but we are given all sufficiency in our shepherd. There is infinite, eternal sufficiency in the good shepherd, the Lord Jesus Christ, who I can draw on for every need that I have. And so we're like sheep. We've all gone our own way. We've all gone astray from the Father. We've wandered from the guardian of our souls. We need a good shepherd to lay down his life for us. We need him to be a door into the kingdom of God, to the pasture of God's people, so that we can be cared for by the shepherd. So if you're visiting or come here weekly, and you're truly trying to find your way to God, you cannot find your way back to God. You have no sense of direction. You will never be able to find that place. So God sent a shepherd who went up on a cross, and he died the death that you deserved. He bore the wrath of God on that cross, so that now coming to him, you can find your way back to pasture. You can find your way back home to be with God. John 14:6, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. I'm the way. I'm the shepherd. I'm the one who will bring you back to the Father. So in this psalm, we're seeking to enter into his rest. We're looking for that Hebrews 4 kind of stuff where it says you can rest in Christ, rest from your works, rest. The one thing I see in America and even in some here this morning is you don't know how to rest. It's this always constant stress, worry, concerns. And what the gospel is, it's an entering into his rest. And he wants us to come now. And this shepherd and sheep analogy is the picture of rest. Find rest for your souls in Jesus Christ. We want to know these truths and experience them, and we want to live into the fullness of what we're looking at in Psalm 23. I'm trying to shepherd you into the shepherd. And so don't be stubborn sheep and baaing and fighting and running off. I want you to hear his voice, and I just want you to follow him. That is really the last point of my sermon last week, is the Lord is my shepherd. This psalm will never do you any good until he is my shepherd. It doesn't help to know and study this psalm and look at all the grammatical parts and understand it in your mind. It will do you no good until you can sit here and say, the Lord is my shepherd. I have come to Christ. I have been saved. He's mine. He's my shepherd. And so I pray that every soul here can say that. And if you can't afterwards, I want you to come up and see me and don't leave till you can say, the Lord is my shepherd. This morning then, I want to apply the beauty of the depth of what we looked at last week. I want to make application to the Lord is my shepherd, as David does. And so I hope you got some time alone with God this week, as I exhorted you to do. And it was quality time, and that you meditated on this reality, that you spent time digging in and wrestling with how deep the Lord is my shepherd, what is all there. And if you didn't, you don't just stumble into this place of contented peace with God. You don't just fall into it listening to music. You don't fall into it hanging out, just doing things. You've got to get alone with God, and you need to sow these things in your heart and your soul. And so I'm going to keep pushing with that. You won't wake up overflowing with this reality by not spending this time with God. So as we apply this truth, the Lord is my shepherd, I want to start first with the opposite of how David applies this truth. As we see in Psalm 21, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. And I want to look at the opposite is the Lord isn't my shepherd, I shall want. What really is the essence of sin? But instead of having God, I've said this before, as the very center reference point of your life, we've been designed to put God as the center reference point of everything. And the fall has come, and now we put self as the center reference point. The very thing that all of my life revolves around is me. And that is how we come into the world, bent and twisted since the fall in the garden, as we are lost, estranged from God, and self is at the center of everything that we seek and do. And this has made shipwreck of our souls and our world as we look out there. Daily we see the reminders of what the fall then has done to this world. It's a world that revolves around self. Excuse me. How to satisfy self. Nothing can reach higher than that. That is the heart of our society. Even the so-called world religions and moral agendas go no higher than self as they look to self for how they'll improve themselves and climb a ladder to get to God. So daily we see the remnants of our flesh that still seeks for self. And so we have these souls that cannot be satisfied. Self-focus and desire will never say enough. Is there any, have you ever met someone very selfish ever say enough? Enough people love me. Everything revolves around me. I'm happy. It just doesn't happen. Self will never get enough. I will never feel content if self is the center reference point of my life. It always cries more. I want more. I want something different. It's an empty well of desire that just cannot be filled. The Lord is not my shepherd. All I can do is want. And maybe that's your condition sitting here this morning. You're just a big bag of wants. It will reveal quickly the very depth of your heart and your soul and who you are. The motto of our world, I've stole it from him before, but I'm going to say it again. That theologian Mick Jagger, I can't get no satisfaction. That's it. Empty people fighting another day, trying to fill up this empty desire. I just hope today I can get a little filling. Always hoping for something that might come that will finally fill this void. That is all life is. I'm trying to fill this void that is a God-shaped void. And I look every day, maybe this will fill it. Maybe this will fill it. And it's just, it's like chasing after wind and I can never get it. So it is the world that wants. It wants security. We'll have retirement funds. Try to get protections against fraud and insurance. I want life insurance, disability insurance, home insurance, auto insurance, health insurance. I want prenuptials. I want savings. All it is a whole world chasing after security. And I just want to find where I can say, ha, I finally have security. But it is never enough. I want protection. I'm afraid of terrorists. I'm afraid of other countries coming and taking us captive. I'm afraid of the police. There's not enough of them. I need a concealed carry. I need security alarms. I need firewalls. I need a sex offender registry. I need mass shooting protection. All of these things, I need protection. And I feel afraid and I feel scared. And no matter what you get, you still feel scared. My daily needs. I want green grass and water. I worry every day about providing for myself and my family. I just need to get enough security that I can care for them. So I live in constant wants because I need to take care of the family that God has given to me. I'm worried about drifting from God. I don't want to go apostate. I don't want a really bad trial. I don't want hard times. I spend my whole life preserving against it. I want protection from that. I take vitamins, I exercise, I lock my kids up so nothing can ever happen to them. They can't drive, I get physicals. I do everything that I can to make sure that I'll never have a hard trial. And I live in fear my whole life. Oh, may it not be. Every time I hear of a trial, oh God, let it not be me. Let it not be me. And you just sit your whole life afraid of the trial that's around the corner and you just live in anxiety. You live your whole life afraid of the dragon behind your closet door. That's your life as you sit here this morning, if that's your case. I just can't get no satisfaction. I honestly worry that God is going to just grow weary of me and all of my sin and quit being loving kindness and good to me. I live in this state of want. I don't feel safe. I don't feel satisfied. I don't like my lot in life. I don't like my spouse. I don't like my kids that turned out to be teenagers. That's not funny. I had a lady, she actually told me that. She said, enjoy your kids. The minute they get hormones, you'll never enjoy them again. I love my teenagers. I love them. My health. I feel so bad. Everyone else is enjoying parties and getting together, and I just sit there fighting to feel good. So that the world is just a place of emptiness. It's a place of futility. It's a wasteland of self-seekers killing each other. I want to get into as many lives as possible and give them the gospel of Jesus Christ to take them from self-seekers to Christ lovers, to go from empty to fullness. Do you have that burden as we look at this morning, that this is the state of anyone without the Lord as their shepherd? And don't you want them to not live in that? Don't you want to find that blessing that you have found in Christ? My burden is that God has given us everything for life and godliness. And so many of us, even as believers, spend way too much of our time just wanting. I think half my discussions are hearing about what people are wanting. And that one thing that's just around the corner will finally bring contentment. I hear that the most. If I just had this, I could be content. If I just had this, I could be content. And it's always that one thing. And I will never be content until I have that one thing. If I could just get that career change, I could get it. If I was in that group, that popular group, I want to be someone. I just want to be a big deal. My finances, every month, it's this stress of I can't pay all my bills. How's it going to work? Every month is that way. And if I could just get out of that, everything could be okay. If my loved one who is sick could just be well. And what's happened is we're just a people wanting. Jeff Stevens, when he was here, preached on this psalm, and he said, we have the sin of comparison. All of our marketing, we got a few marketing majors in here. It's all designed for that bad boy that everyone's comparing each other. And I'm going to market, and I'm going to say, if you have this, you'll be better than Jimmy down the road. And I just want to keep everyone wanting to be better than the guy next door. And there's always this comparison. We look at others, and we just want what they have. There's a family, they just all get along. I want that family so bad. I have this, but someone's saying, I want a wife who submits. I want a husband who will just love me. If I could just have what she has. Their house has a finished basement. I could bring people into our home. Their toddler can already read. Mine only says mommy. How many moms have done that? If I had that role in life, I would use it for God. And we just spend all of this time in comparison. And the Good Shepherd did not come so that we would be a bunch of unhappy people. I'm going to say that twice. The Good Shepherd did not come so we'd be a bunch of unhappy people who just want, I want, I want, I want, who contentment is always around the corner. That is not it. One pay raise away, one cure, one job, and then I will be content. Jesus says, I have come that you might have life and that you might have it more abundantly. In me, there is abundant life. I want you to find that and flourish and be these fat little sheep laying down in green pastures, contented and happy. I've come that you would be fatted, happy, content sheep under my sovereign care and my protection. I am your shepherd. You shall not want. You shall not lack. The crazy, fast-paced, pressured lives that our calling they're calling us to simplicity, to dwell with the Good Shepherd by being his sheep. As Americans, there is such a pressure of this hurriedness and rush, and God's calling us to stop in the middle of it, to stop it, and to be these people who can live in peace and contentedness with their God, by being his sheep. I shall not want, I shall not lack anything. I can live into this and be that sheep laying down without a shade of worry, without a shade of doubt. Guys, it's possible. Jesus came for us to have this. The Good Shepherd wants to lead you into this morning, to delight in this shepherding God. To let our hearts find their full satisfaction in him and not in lesser pleasures. He wants you to quit finding it in lesser pleasures and to find it in him. Jonathan Edwards said the Christian life is to enjoy and reflect the beauty of God. He wants you to enjoy all of his beauty and to reflect that to this world. enjoy it. This is what our crazy world is crying for. They're looking for it on every turn. And this is what we then as believers can reflect to them, souls completely satisfied on God. They will be begging to come into the kingdom. Souls that are not afraid, souls that are not wanting. People contented in the good shepherd, no matter what we face, will draw them in from all the corners of the world if they see that. But sometimes it takes heart attacks to find it. Sometimes it takes 10 hours on an airplane alone with God. And sometimes it takes dreams that go sour and you can't make sense of it all. Sometimes it takes a marriage that breaks or a loved one that we have to bury. But for certain, silencing of this wanting world in our ears to find that the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. So let's look at this phrase briefly before I send you home. That's my longest introduction of the year. Verse 1, Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. That is such a bold statement. This is a sheep utterly satisfied with his owner and his shepherd, perfectly content with his lot in life. The Hebrew word for want, it really does. It means to not lack, not deficient in proper care. So because he's my shepherd, I lack nothing. I have the sufficient care for my soul and my life. It carries the idea of utterly contented in the good shepherd's care. Is that your picture this morning? I'm utterly contented in that good shepherd's care. And consequently, not craving or desiring anything more. Because I have the good shepherd, I have everything for life and godliness. I have everything that I need. So I don't want you to fall off the other side of the fence. Is it sin to want anything? No. We're creatures that have desires. I want to eat. I want companionship, clothing, car, shelter. We want things. This is the person, though, who's contented in being a sheep, trusting his shepherd for all of his care. They want to eat. Sheep want water. They want wolves gone. There's desires. But it's a contented sheep in the shepherd. I know I'm safe because of the shepherd. I know I'm cared for because of my shepherd. The believer can face many hardships. Jesus said, in this world, you will have tribulation. But take heart, I have overcome the world. This is not our home. Yet it's possible on this journey to our true home, which I think is what this psalm is this psalm is the yearly cycle of what a shepherd did with his sheep. And so we're going to trace the whole cycle, and it ends up back at home, leading the sheep to that sweet spot where I can say, I shall not want because of my manager, my master, my shepherd. And so I think what is going on here is what we saw in the Sermon on the Mount, where Jesus said, you can't serve two masters. You can't serve this world and you can't serve mammon for its the approval and acceptance in this world. You're going to hate one and love the other. You need to serve God and God alone. And he wants an undivided heart. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want because that is what I want. I want him. A regenerated heart says, I want God. And so I don't want because I have everything. I have all of him. I have his fullness, his abundance. I'm full because of the fullness of God. It's interesting to me that Timothy Keller, the book I told you about, he shares about when he was in South Africa as a shepherd, there was a tenant right next to him who was shepherding. And he said, this man did not care for the land or the sheep. He said, many of the sheep fell prey to dogs, cougars, and rustlers. The grass was brown and impoverished. Shelter from storms, there was only a few, and they were very shoddy. So when the storms would come, they really couldn't find protection. The water was polluted and muddy, and therefore, he said, the sheep were thin and weak and diseased because their owner simply didn't care for them. And again, I said last week, the taskmaster called Satan. He doesn't care about the sheep under his care. If you're an unbeliever, you're under the worst shepherd there is. He's a taskmaster who doesn't care, and you're deficient and you're weak and it's killing you. And maybe that's why you're here this morning saying, I know there's got to be a remedy for this state. It's under the wrong shepherd. What is it that they want? Green grass and fresh water and shade and safety and shelter from the storms. These sheep wanted relief from their wounds and their disease and their parasites. Well, come to the good shepherd. The one thing I've learned in this life by being a pastor and living it for 50 years, it is your master that makes the difference in your journey. Who your master is going to make all the difference in the way you journey. And I've had to shepherd sheep, and every once in a while the enemy brings in, you know, goats, and he brings in tares, and they're the hardest people to shepherd in their lives. The journey is they're not happy. But a believer can be contented and satisfied in God. And so the same hardships and trials come upon both kind of pastures. Those who know God and those who don't. But those who don't know God become bitter and unhappy and jaded. They become just bitter people. But I've watched those under the good shepherd. This is my favorite part about being a pastor, is it's so sweet to watch a saint grow old who knows the good shepherd and lives under this sweet reality. They just grow sweeter and sweeter with the more trials and the more afflictions that come into their life. It's a beautiful thing. They're like just fine wine. And age just keeps making them better and better. The more pressure applied, the sweeter the wine that comes out by the one under the good shepherd. I get to watch this on a daily basis. Sheep completely satisfied with their management of their lives because he cares for his sheep. I want you to listen to Keller on this as well. He says, I'm completely satisfied with his management of my life. Why? Because he is the sheepman to whom no trouble is too great as he cares for his flock. This is describing an earthly shepherd. He's the rancher who is outstanding because of his fondness for the sheep. He loves them for their own sake, as well as his personal pleasure in them. He will, if necessary, be on the job 24 hours a day to see that they are properly provided for in every detail. Above all, he's very jealous of his name and his high reputation as the good shepherd. He is the owner who delights in his flock. For him, there is no greater reward, no deeper satisfaction than that of seeing his sheep contented. The shepherd finds this great joy when his sheep are content, when they're well fed, when they're safe, and they're flourishing under his care. This is indeed his very life as a shepherd. He gives all he has to bring it about. He literally lays himself out for those who are his. He'll go to no end of trouble and labor to supply them with the finest grazing, the richest pasturage, ample winter feed, and clean water. He will spare himself no pains to provide shelter from storms, protection from ruthless enemies, and the diseases and parasites to which sheep are so susceptible. No wonder Jesus said, I am the good shepherd. And the good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The good shepherd is on the alert 24/7. He rises early and he goes and he looks over the flock. He examines them to see if they're ready and fit to be put on their feet. He can tell if they were hurt during the night or if they're ill. Throughout the day, he gazes to make sure that they're well. He sleeps with one eye open and both ears to protect them. Oh, how sweet it is that the Lord is my shepherd. I could bask in this the rest of my life. It is so satisfying and joyful to think on it. And I love that he said, a shepherd's delight is when his sheep are contented and well cared for. God delights when we are contented in him and live into that and manifest it to this world. Despite such a shepherd, there are those who are not content with his control and with his shepherding. And they fight him all of their days. They're always fighting God. They're dissatisfied, trying to feed on the grass that's beyond the fence. I know all the time there's the other side of the fence will make me happier. Outside of God's will, doing this girlfriend, it's something outside of the fence is what's going to truly make me happy. The grass is greener on the other side. And they don't believe then that God is a good shepherd. Satan has withheld all good things from you. But they believe you'll be happier in this relationship, even if it's unbiblical. I'm going to spend all of my money on me, not some kingdom. That'll make me happy. A friend, John Collins, who had a heart attack, he shared this week, he said, we fought the life of the body, really what the body of Christ is supposed to be, and it is so sweet and satisfying. I love it. And here it is. I'm fighting what God has given to me. I read an article this week about millennials with sex outside of marriage. And there's just, they've lost their edges completely. And lost that God says that the immoral will not inherit the kingdom of God. But this is what will make me happy. And I've just watched it destroy person after person who's ever bit that lie. The person who says, I will establish my own security. I will be happier if I call the shots. I know better how to run my life. It's crazy. Here is the perfect shepherd with perfect grass, lying down in it, protected from your enemies. And everything is just so good and beautiful. Can't you picture it? That is what Keller had. He said he had the best grazing of any place in that whole region. And it was beautiful. And yet, there was this one sheep that always wanted the other dead grass, the other side of the fence, this death trap next door. And this sheep, he said, this one was so beautiful. It was lovely and perfect. Its wool was just to look at, was amazing. This one sheep, he said, caused me more problems than all of my other sheep combined. I had a son like that. And I ain't going to tell you which one. But if anyone's good at observation, you probably know. This sheep was always trying to feed on the other side of the fence. The grass wasn't greener, it was brown. But this sheep, he said, he always wanted the other side of the fence. And she was never contented with how things were that the good shepherd was giving to the sheep. Always dissatisfied in what the good shepherd had for them. And you might be that. Always dissatisfied with whatever the good shepherd has for you in your life, what he's doing, how he's working. You're like that little sheep that he's talking about. I want the other side of the fence. That will make me happy. I want. And he said she fence crawled all the time. And Keller says no matter how much I did for her, she just was never satisfied. And he said eventually I had to slaughter it. Because it wouldn't stop. And all the other sheep started to follow what this sheep was doing. And so I pray that there's no fence crawlers here today. That you just spend your whole life always thinking that the good shepherd has given you something less than what you need or want. And happiness is always outside the fence of this beautiful place of the will of God. Living into relationship with him, abiding, dwelling, knowing this God is where contentment is to be found. And so no matter what God does for you, as the good shepherd, these people always want the other side of the fence. And so I pray that this morning that we could all say, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. I think this is the key to over, sin is wanting. And if you're fighting sin and you just feel like you're getting nowhere, I'm telling you, this is the secret, is that the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. When I get this, and when I live into this, and I know I have everything in him, and cared for, and everything, and sin comes, it can't draw me away from that. Sin comes and says, this is what will make you happy. There's no way. Nothing will ever make me happier than this. And it will begin to give you strength in your battles and your fights against sin, is to be so contented in the good shepherd and what he is and who he is for you. That we will live this glorious Christian life and we will put God on display to a world that wants, to a world that doesn't understand what we're talking about here this morning. So guys, there really is a decision to make. That we come through the door that can only be the door is Jesus Christ. There's no other way into this sheepfold. There's no other way into the kingdom of God but to come with nothing in your hands. Done trying to clean yourself up, be good enough religion, fixing yourself up and looking only to the finished work of Jesus Christ. He's the door. He's the only way you'll ever enter into the kingdom of God. Will you believe his word? And will you be content with with the Good Shepherd and everything that he brings into your life and how he works and how he moves and what he's doing to grow you and make you a fatted, contented sheep with everything that you need for life and godliness. Last week I said that when a shepherd would buy his sheep, you give your life to care for them. And now the Good Shepherd has given himself to us. Our shepherd is Yahweh. Guys, we have the living God who now we live in his favor because of the work of Christ. And he is our shepherd. And I pray that every soul will say with me this morning, I shall not want. I am so satisfied in him and what he's doing in my life. I have everything that I need. Will you spend all of your days being spooked and wanting, or will you enter into the sweet rest of Jesus Christ? I prayed for every one of you. I just prayed that God would give every one of us this glorious I shall not want. Amen? Amen. Let's pray together and ask the Good Shepherd for this. Yahweh, we come before you, and I love that because of the work of Jesus Christ and because of the gift of faith that you have given to us and granted us the gift of repentance, God, that we've turned from the falsehoods, we've turned from the lies of our own hands, we've turned from this world and its sin, and we have turned to the living Christ. We have turned to him alone for life and salvation. We have turned alone to him to be our shepherd. And so, God, I thank you. What a beautiful picture that we're sheep and you are our shepherd. God, I shall not want. I look forward to the weeks ahead of seeing the way you care for your sheep. And I pray that every heart here would be set free from worry and running and trying to do things in their own strength and accomplish things by their own ways. And I just ask, Lord, that we at Southside Bible Church would be contented, fat, happy sheep laying down in green grass that you have provided. God, you've given us everything to be these kind of sheep. And so, Lord, I just think of Christ on that boat with the storm, and he just said, shh, and the waves flattened out. I pray that as what we just looked at, that you would do the same thing in every mind and heart. Just say, shh. God, calm the waves. And every troubled, worrying, not entering to rest heart here this morning. And let everyone find shalom and peace. That the Lord is my shepherd. And Jesus Christ has done everything to bring us into this place of rest. God, I thank you. It's better than Goshen. It's better than the promised land. We thank you that we dwell right now in the perfect place of rest that you promised to give in Jesus Christ. God, help us to quit being Americans who are troubled and wanting. God, the land of plenty is a land of wanters. And I pray that we will go forth as your people shining a light of just contentedness in our God, and it would make them thirst for the living God, and they would say, what is the hope within you? God, use us in this way. For your name's sake, we pray in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.